long is the journey to Mars? Think about this. Try to imagine the expansion of human civilization into space as if it were a child hopping from one rock to another, trying to cross a river. The first stone, or the first leap, the one that allowed confidence to build, was quite close to the shore, just 400,000 kilometers away. We're talking about the moon, of course, a large satellite conveniently close to home, almost inviting us not to fear. But the next stone, just emerging from the water, is 1,000 times farther than the first. A truly frightening leap. And we're talking about Mars, obviously. Here, the child stops to reflect. He's afraid, even though he still wants to try. But how? What are the chances of success? In plain terms, reading certain articles suggests that many volunteers are willing to jump, no matter what happens. But is it true? And has anyone warned them that going to Mars is not like going to the moon? Are they aware that the estimated duration of this journey from Earth to Mars is not 3 days, but several months? Do they also know that due to the geometry of planetary positions, it's expected that the duration of a mission to Mars, including the outbound trip, stay, and return journey, revolves around 2 years? Well, if they still don't know, in this extraordinary video, we'll try to explain it to them. The journey to Mars should not be taken lightly. The child on the riverbank knows this, and rightfully, he doesn't trust it. It was July 1969 when Neil Armstrong and Buzz Aldrin first set foot on the moon. The father of the U.S. space program, Wernher von Braun, believed sending astronauts to Mars was a matter of, at most, a couple of decades. But now we're in 2024. We've sent orbiters, landers, and rovers to Mars, yet no human has set foot on the red planet. Why? Political motivations have certainly dwindled, namely the space race between the USA and the USSR. Consequently, funds for NASA were cut to finance other controversial activities. Objectively, there are also significant technical challenges. Going to the moon only takes 3 days, a time during which the survival of a crew without the possibility of resupply is certainly possible, as revealed by the famous incident on Apollo 13. Instead, a journey to Mars requires several months one way, with all the risks associated with prolonged exposure to microgravity, communication delays, exposure to solar and cosmic radiation, and the impossibility of short and medium-term rescue or resupply. But in concrete terms, why does a journey to Mars take so long? To understand this, we first need to visualize the fact that Mars and Earth orbit the Sun in two nearly circular and concentric paths, spaced about 0.52 astronomical units apart, or roughly 78 million kilometers. Importantly, as deduced from Kepler's third law, Mars orbits the Sun with an average speed of 24 kilometers per second, significantly lower than our planet, which moves at 30 kilometers per second. So much so that Earth takes 1 year to complete a revolution, while Mars requires 1.88 years. Before moving on, don't forget to subscribe to our channel if you haven't already. Make sure to hit the notification bell so you don't miss out on our daily videos. We can imagine Earth and Mars as two cyclists on a track, with the outer one, Mars, moving more slowly than the inner one, Earth. One of the many questions that arise in these cases is, how often does the inner cyclist reach and overtake the outer one? The calculation is straightforward, telling us that the inner cyclist, in this case Earth, will reach Mars, or align with it on the line connecting them with the Sun, every 780 days, an interval also defined as the synodic period. This means that every 2.14 years, Earth will reach the minimum distance from Mars, as mentioned earlier, which is 78 million kilometers, and then move past it and consequently move away. To slightly complicate matters, we must note that the orbits of the two planets, especially that of Mars, are not perfect circles, but ellipses with some eccentricity. So the distance at the time of overtaking can vary up to a minimum of 54 million kilometers every 15 to 17 years. Well, now we have all the elements to address the most important question. With which optimal trajectories, orbits, can we reach Mars? At first glance, one might say, well, let's wait to reach the minimum distance from Mars and shoot a probe straight at it. No, unfortunately, things in space don't work that way. It would be like shooting an arrow at a moving target from a moving vehicle. In the arrow's flight time, the target would move, and we would miss it by a considerable margin. To hit the target, the archer would need to aim at the point where the target will be when the arrow arrives, not where it is when the arrow is released. Okay, but interplanetary space is a bit different from a shooting range. In space, the distances at play are immensely larger, and spacecraft as well as planets move primarily under the influence of the sun's gravity. And so there's no escaping it. The universal law of gravitation and the laws of dynamics tells us that a spacecraft will have to follow an elliptical trajectory once the initial thrust is exhausted. And since the orbits of the planets are more or less pronounced ellipses, all we have to do is find an elliptical orbit that, starting from Earth, then intersects the Martian orbit when Mars is just around those parts. The trouble is that to shorten the flight duration, it would be necessary to ignite the engine for an extended period to increase speed. However, this would entail carrying a large amount of propellant. The additional mass would in turn require more propellant to be transported into orbit and accelerated. This situation persists until we transition from chemical propulsion to ion or nuclear propulsion. Additionally, it's essential to note that it's not impossible to arbitrarily increase the speed of a vehicle destined for landing on Mars. Spacecraft must arrive slowly enough to execute orbital insertion maneuvers rather than simply pass by the intended destination. There's another matter to consider. Is it indeed true that a journey to Mars can only be made once every 2 years? If so, why? In reality, a journey to Mars can take place at any time, but the challenge lies in fuel consumption and time requirements. Using the simple home and transfer orbit, launch windows are influenced by the so-called synodic period, the 780-day interval between two maximum close approaches of Earth and Mars. Every 780 days, there's a launch period of one or more months, with launch windows spanning a few hours each day. In more complex scenarios, including gravitational slingshots, launch periods become irregular. Occasionally, rare opportunities arise, such as when Voyager 2 took advantage of a planetary alignment that occurs every 175 years to visit Jupiter, Saturn, Uranus, and Neptune. But are we not only constrained by the synodic period for the outbound journey? Also for the return, in the case of a crewed mission, we would be compelled to await the favorable alignment of the two planets. This leads us to consider the most unpleasant aspect of a mission to Mars, namely that, considering the outbound journey, forced stay, and return, the duration of an expedition to the Red Planet could not be less than 15 to 24 months, assuming the use of significant amounts of energy. The home and transfer orbit, which is the one with the lowest propellant consumption, would result in a travel time of about 8.5 months from Earth to Mars, approximately 15 months stationed on Mars awaiting the optimal transfer window to Earth, and a travel time of 8.5 months to return to Earth. This totals 33 months, almost 3 years. This means that astronauts will have to stay on Mars for more than a year, entirely isolated, with all that entails, before getting a chance to return home. If we also consider the outbound and return journeys, we are facing a mission plan that requires approximately 1,000 days of space habitation, with a crew of 4 to 5 people tens of millions of kilometers away. That's why going to Mars is not a walk in the park. It requires meticulous planning of every project step and addressing every mission challenge. And so I'd like to say to that hesitant child facing the fjord, think carefully before leaping onto that distant emerging rock. After all, you can still decide not to cross the river and return home safely tonight.